time because she didn't know what was going on. And she, you know, the thing is, all right, this is a really weird example, but that show Vikings, I like it. And this Ragnar Lothbrok kidnaps this Catholic, I guess, priest, you know, a monk, someone in a monastery. And the guy in the monastery asks questions, and Ragnar answers them about the culture. So it's it's the classic, bring in someone who doesn't know the culture so they can tell you about the culture so you don't have to deliver like expository dialogue. But Hayden Christensen doesn't say anything to her. He's like, let's go. Let's just go. Come on. Let's go.
Yeah.
Let's go.
And she just follows.
Yeah.
She just follows, you know?
Yeah.
He comes out of nowhere after they knew each other in, what, high school? He comes out of nowhere. He's bulky. He's quote-unquote sexy now. And, oh, I'm in banking. Well, you failed algebra. Oh, I'm not lying. Okay, then. And then sex scene. You know what I'm saying? Terrible sex scene. The love and the date montage. She's not a strong female character. It's not her fault.
Yeah,
it wasn't written well.
She was trying to fight for... She was like, I'm just really tired of saying this. And also, during the commentary, there are these three men who are just saying, you know, we didn't know if we wanted to clue this because we didn't want her character to be trampy. And I'm like, am I listening to three dudes talk about this? And then they're like, they said, the great thing about Rachel Bilson is that she's very sweet. And this is her own decision. So she's not... she's not trampy. She's like sweet.
Jesus.
And this, it's not a carnal sex scene. It's a, and I'm sitting here going, oh my goodness, this is a pretty gnarly,
This is the mansplaining. This is what they talk about right there.
Yeah.
Because obviously she, early on when she's a creepy looking, weird Natalie Portman discount vague girl, you know,
cause
they absolutely went for that in the beginning of the movie when they're younger. She's a creepy discount Natalie Portman. She seemed smart. She was kind. She was sweet. When she was trying to stop him from being beat up by the bully, when the guy was trying to take his, you know, the little diorama of Paris, whatever it was, with the...
Rice bowl.
You know what I mean?
Snow globe.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, the snow globe. Thank you. Jesus. I said
rice bowl.
Because that's his name. His nickname is Rice Bowl the whole time, and I'm why is he Rice Bowl? Oh, his name is Rice. You don't figure that out until like 40 minutes into the movie.
Wow. I always wondered, why is he calling him Rice Bowl?
It's his name. It's his name. Derek Rice or Damien Rice. So much of this movie they just leave out because they can't wait to get to the CGI fights.
Wait, Damien Rice, that's a musician. I like him.
Is it?
Blower's Daughter. I like that. No,
is that Can't Take My Eyes Off of You? Is that a different guy?
Yeah, no, I think that's Damien Rice, and that's from that Closer movie where just four people
four people are being
terrible to each other.
Exactly, but they're in love.
They should
creepy
on the poster. It should say Closer, like we're horrible to each other.
Can't take my eyes off of you.
I'm gonna rip your heart out this summer. This summer, four actors will rip each other's hearts out. Julia Roberts, Natalie Portman, Jude Law, and Clive Owen starring the summer.
Clive Owen, yeah, that's right.
You will never feel better about feeling bad. Closer. You will never feel better about feeling bad? Hey now.
There it is. There it is.
Hey now.
Did you enjoy our date? Yes. I hate you. Let's make love.
Can't take my eyes.
I wonder how many guys bought guitars to sing that song after Closer came out.
God, just brutal.
Well, I know you did.
Brutal. Well, hey, listen.
That's the first time I messed you. You were busking on a street corner in Korea.
You were not supposed to put that on this podcast. I'm leaving. Oh my God, I can't believe you revealed my terrible secret.
But I love that you were singing it in Portuguese, which is pretty amazing because you're a Life Aquatic fan.
Mis ojos no está aquí. Wait, that's Spanish.
No, I have to say something about this movie. There's Dawn of the Dead, where for years, anywhere I walked around, I would think about how to barricade myself if zombies attacked. Like, anywhere I go now, I'm like, how could I protect myself from zombies? Just because of Dawn of the Dead. But this jumper idea, I know... Probably people had jumped in the past, but I liked the idea a lot. I think this is a cool power, and I don't know. I've thought about jumping a lot, and I think it's
dude, you have to.
Yeah.
Jump face.
Jump face.
You know what I'm saying? That's why we created the jump face, because it was awesome.
I mean, it's a very cool concept. And I guess one thing I understand with Liman and Christensen, so this guy grew up, he had no challenges in his life whatsoever. He's just insulting people. He's watching people, you know, he's watching people die in swamps and floods, and he's not helping. This is just kind of a dude who just doesn't, he doesn't care. He just lives a life of leisure, and this is our hero. And
he is.
Liman wanted to keep him as unhearable as long as possible.
As non-heroic as possible, you're saying. Yes, that's right. If you remember early on in the movie, there's a scene where you see the people in a flood, and they're saying it would take a miracle to save them. And Hayden Christensen is like, oh, I'm going to go surfing in Australia.
Yep.
He gives it the whatever look. So absolutely, they were leaning towards that. But the script wasn't written well enough to actually develop the anti-hero thing.
One of the vibes I did like is they kept it moving a lot as a jumper would move. I never want a jumper stand. Like, so I think there are elements that worked to it.
Yeah, totally.
I think he went in with a different idea than everyone realized this is a bad idea. Then he kind of had to turn it around a little bit. And then that cost the movie. Does that make sense?
It does. It does. Because actually the book is really dark, man.
Oh, really?
The book is really dark.
What's covered in that?
His mom is killed in a terrorist attack. His father is incredibly abusive. And he spends his time in the book trying to find his mother's killer and bring his father to justice for what he did to his mom.
It's
really a dark book, man. It's dark. And actually, the way that things are in 2019, it would be a really great Netflix movie, to be honest with you.
Well, you know, they made a YouTube Red
series of this?
Yeah. And Jamie Bell, as the latest as last year, was talking about doing another spinoff because he loves the character. He hated filming the movie, but he loves the character.
Yeah, the character is interesting, but that character was not in all that paladin stuff. It wasn't in the book at all.
Yeah, you know what's an interesting concept?
It was.
And the YouTube Red show, from what I read, the antagonist, the girl that's in it, she can only jump home. So if she's at school, you know, she can jump home, but she can't jump anywhere else. So she has to figure out her powers.
For
a TV show, you gotta keep that budget down. So I guess that makes sense. And then she'll probably split, like, if you get a second season, you get more money.
Yeah, but the hilarity is YouTube talking about keeping the budget down.
Yeah,
you're
right.
AKA Google. Get out of here, son.
Yeah, you're right.
That's hilarious. You know, we're not talking AMC, you know what I'm saying? where they have the characters of The Walking Dead on the farm for 12 episodes because they're trying to keep the budget down so they can set everything on fire.
I was on set season 2 as a stand-in for one of the episodes. And
really?
Yeah, this is when I was just starting in the industry. And they cast me to stand in for Scott Wilson, but I'm about 7 inches taller than him. And everyone was just looking
definitely.
At me. And what I found out it was a kneeling scene. So I was like, oh my gosh. And the AD walked up to me like, did you like say you were short? I'm like, no, I'm on an, so I was doing a movie called Jay Mansfield's Car with Billy Bob Thornton. I did that whole run, but one day they just didn't need me, even though I had been booked. So they're like, well, we'll get you another job on something else. And I was like, well, I don't know if I want to do that. They're like, well, Walking Dead. I'm like, oh, okay. So I went there and I didn't throw anybody under the bus. I'm like, well, that just happened. They figured they wanted to get me something. So everyone on set understood and we kind of laughed about it, but I was on that farm. And it was a mile away from the stage. So yeah, they definitely, their stage has been 8 different things in that, that world. Going back to Michael Rooker, who was in Walking Dead, heyo. And we just did a cliffhanger pod that Michael Rooker was in, heyo. And we're doing a Slither pod coming up.
Oh my God. I just watched that this week.
Slither?
I swear to God.
Did you really?
Cliffhanger.
Oh man.
I swear to God, I love that movie.
I could go on
I'm sorry.
I got questions for you about that, but we can do that on our own time.
That's another time.
Yeah, exactly. But Michael Rooker, when we first meet Michael Rooker, this is what happens. The kid comes into the home. Michael Rooker says dinner is cold. So Michael Rooker cooked dinner for him. Then he asks the nice question, hey, where have you been? And then he notices, you're soaking and it's freezing. Are you okay? What's wrong? Then the kid walks upstairs spreading puddles all over the floor. And Rooker's like, hey, man, get a mop. Clean this up. Like, I'm not... So this is one of those cases where, and there are movies like this where, you know, you have a, like a girl, you know, when sometimes in romantic comedies, the boyfriend or the girlfriend that's going to get broken up to has to like at the end just be a complete turd. But then there's those movies where they're actually pretty nice and then they get broken up with and you're like, these people are terrible.
That's right.
But in this one, they didn't really make Michael Rooker to be bad.
Well, they were trying to set him up as, I am terrible father Michael Rooker. I see that you have clearly been attacked by bullies at school, but, oh, my only concern is the mess on the floor because your mother left me. And I'm kind of an alcoholic because you see me drinking beer and watching Family Guy, but not really. And also, I don't shave. It was just poorly drawn, you know, as a character. He was poorly drawn. Like I said, in the book, man, you know, he absolutely beat the crap out of him and the mother.
Oh, wow.
But they didn't set it up that way in the book. He's just kind of a dick father as opposed to, you know, Ike Turner.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
And it's a nice house.
But I thought that was hilarious, too.
They live in a nice house.
It was a nice house.
Yeah, and the kid has Master of Puppets poster on his walls. He has his clothes look kind of expensive. He has a haircut. He has food on the table.
He's supposed to be an outsider.
Yeah. So
he's an outsider.
So here's this dad whose mom, like, she left him without telling him probably, what, 8-9 years ago. That probably destroyed him emotionally. And, and then his child leaves him. I mean, I'm sure he's not going to win any awards, but I don't know. He's, you don't get the vibe that he's the worst. Maybe as much.
No.
Yeah.
Well, it's because it's Michael Rooker. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It takes a lot. Listen, Michael Rooker has absolutely played a bad guy in a lot of movies, you know, and he will dive into it and he will chew a scene even when he's not supposed to. But this movie, Michael Rooker's wasted. Diane Lane is wasted.
Well, you know,
because
what?
It's all about sexy Hayden Christensen. Look at me pout. You know what I mean?
You know why they said they brought in Diane Lane and Kristen Stewart and Michael Rooker? They had Tom Hulse from Amadeus teaching.
Yes, that guy's awesome.
Amazing actors. And what happened was Doug Liman and Kinberg brought them on saying, when we make these movies, we want to have huge names to make the world bigger. So you see Diane Lane, you're going, whoa, Diane Lane's in this movie? And you see this person. So I think that was a smart idea, but there's no sequel. So it feels like the people are wasted, correct?
Yeah, correct.
Because, I mean, I guess.
And then she shows up. Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, go for it.
She shows up when he's in jail in Italy. You have 20 seconds, get out. And then, so you think, okay, mom cares. Mom is still alive. What's going on with mom? Then at the end of the movie, oh, so mom, you're a paladin? Yes, and I'm going to hunt you. I'll give you a head start. What the hell?
Yeah, and Kristen Stewart was mean mugging him too.
Yeah, totally. Totally. You know, they think he's some kind of freak. Here's the real question, Hoffmeyer. Your kid is a jumper. Do you castigate him and try to murder him? Or do you just, hey, man, you need to hop in to that bank, grab that cash, and let's just ball out. You know what I mean? It's just not a good premise. The way that they changed the book.
Yeah.
The way that they changed the book, they took all the emotional stuff, all the heart stuff, all the character stuff out, and they made it into, you know, just summer sci-fi romp, which is fine. But then don't make Diane Lane's character hunt him at the end or say she's going to hunt him at the end. It's just too much.
I would wake my kid up at like 1 a.m. and I'm like, hey, go to the liquor store and grab me that expensive bottle.
Totally. Wake up. Give me all the scotch. Do it or else you're not getting fed. Let's go.
Now, I do like Jamie Bell's story because his parents were killed when he was 5 years old. And he's been going to war with these, like, he has a paladin sitting chained to a radiator, unconscious, and then he drops him in shark infested waters in the Atlantic and kills him. This is a guy who has been in the trenches for 20 years. And he doesn't mind blowing up an entire block to kill these paladins.
One paladin. That's the movie we should have been seeing. Absolutely.
I kind of like that you have the new jumper who's just lived a selfish life, who had that luxury, with a jumper who has had that life of turmoil. And I heard in the commentary, too, that they wanted to make this like the second